I'm going to introduce my friend to you, Dr. David Foster, in just a minute, but I need to talk to you for a minute before we get into today. I know many of you are aware that we're going to talk about very sensitive, personal issues today. You've been praying, and I thank God for that. I want to let you know kind of what this morning's going to look like. David and I, Dr. Foster and I, are going to talk about the subject of homosexuality and what does the Bible say. Now, we're going to take you on a bit of a journey that is going to have three different elements to it. It's going to have a theological element to it. It's going to have a cultural element to it. It's going to have a practical element to it. I guess we could add a fourth. It's going to have a hopeful element to it. But we're going to kind of look at this from several different angles today. I have to make this really, really clear. I have no stones in my hand. David has no stones in his hand. We have no stones in our pocket. We're not here with hate speech. We're not here to win arguments. We are here to simply address the issue of homosexuality from the scripture. Okay, now you can say, well, I don't believe the Bible, and you know, I don't like the Bible, and I'm going to keep living how I'm going to live, and then, you know, I can't do anything. It's a free country. You can live however you want. I'm not going to not love you. I'm not going to scream at you. I'm not going to feel like I lost or that we lost or none of that. We are simply living in a time where the church needs to know what she believes and what the scripture says. And so we are here today not to throw stones, not to be mean or angry, not to, you know, spew hate speech, but we're here simply to communicate what the Bible says about this issue that is really, really prevalent in our day and time. And so that's our purpose. You can misinterpret maybe what we say. You can say that, we should have said it a different way or whatever, and, you know, maybe that's true. But what you can't deny is the love that I have in my heart, the love that Dr. Foster has in his heart for people who are struggling with homosexuality and same-sex attraction, whether they're practicing or not, or whether they're just living with same-sex attraction. You can't deny that. You don't know the tears I've cried. You don't know the people I've walked with. You don't know the feet I've washed. So any people out there that want to take a part of this and take some soundbite and say that, you know, this is what Pastor Steve said or is teaching, you know, I can't prevent you from doing that. I can't prevent you from doing that. But I think at the conclusion of the matter today, you're going to be able to hear words of love and grace and hope and healing for people that really are longing for it. They just don't know where to get it. So it's kind of my disclaimer this morning. I have with me a dear friend, Dr. David Foster, who isn't just a friend. He's a part of our church, been a part of our church for years. Dr. Foster is one of the foremost authorities on homosexuality, same-sex attraction. He has a fantastic ministry in Pure Passion and Mastering Life Ministries, a TV show. He's an author. He's a conference speaker. And so could you make Dr. Foster feel welcome this morning? The first time that I had lunch with David, we sat for 3 hours in the restaurant, and I was spellbound. At the time, I said, David's testimony, what God has done in his life, was the single greatest testimony I've ever heard, ever. What God can do in somebody's life. And I think all these years later, David, I don't know that anybody has surpassed you in terms of testimony and what God's done.
Yeah, I wonder what you mean by that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, you were a train wreck.
Exactly.
And God just did the most amazing thing in your life.
The greatest train wreck in history.
That's right. So anyway, I just want you to know he's here as my friend. He's here as a member of our church. He's here as an authority. He's here as a man who has a burden and a love for people. And so, David, give us a little of your story.
Well, I just want to say, to start off, that what we're about to say and what we're about to show you on the video, I did not believe at all for the first 29 years of my life. I would have been very angry at the thought of what we're about to say. I lived homosexually attracted for the first 20 years. The first 10, I did not act on it. But it was a great thorn in my flesh. I did not want to be gay. Most people don't. And I begged God to change me, and tears night after night after night, and not understanding why he wouldn't answer that prayer. Of course, I was sort of giving him an ultimatum. I'll follow you if you change me. Kind of an ultimatum is what I was really doing, but I didn't know I was doing that. And then the next 10 years, I went into the lifestyle heavily, very deeply, slept with over 1,000 men at least, major sex addict in that realm. And I was completely into it, because as far as I was concerned, the God I now hated didn't love me, and therefore I was going to show him how much I hated him by doing the very things I didn't think he wanted me to do. So that's what I set out to do, was to live a life showing my hatred of God. And but the last experience, and that went on for 10 years, and I was an actor in Hollywood, so you can imagine the intensity of the lifestyle that the film industry adds to that. But the last experience I had in the lifestyle, I was in a gay bar, and I was looking at the old man sitting at the bar. Everybody else was dancing and partying and having a great time. But there was these sad and lonely men sitting at the bar, drinking themselves into a stupor. And it suddenly hit me. They have lost their looks and their youth, and they're coming to the sad realization that no one has really ever loved them, that the lifestyle they gave themselves to does not pay out. It does not provide what they're looking for. It never can. And so they lived a promiscuous life, going from person to person to person, trying to find some fulfillment and completion that they could never get by doing that. But they didn't know any better, and they did it. And now they're sad and lonely. And I said to myself, I am never going to end up like that. And so I started searching for God again, even though I thought he hated me and thought me the worst person on the planet. I did love Jesus. I just didn't like his father. And just like I didn't like my father, I had a kind of a harsh, stern father. And so I decided to go to Israel and find Jesus. And so I hopped on a plane and I went there, and I was asking the Lord, Lord, I don't know how to get out of this. I don't know how to stop doing this, being this. If you want me to, you're going to have to do it for me, because I've tried everything I know how to do. And I can't imagine you're even listening to me now. And what he did was, he poured out a river of living water into my soul in that moment when I was approaching him at the most rudimentary level of approaching God you can imagine. He poured this river of living water into my soul, literally. I'm not talking symbolically. This literally happened to me. This raging, rushing river started pouring into my soul, like being at the bottom of Niagara Falls and having it hitting you with full force. That's how intense it was. And it had the sound of raging rivers and millions of voices. And it was this, and as intense and as scary as it was, it felt like liquid love. If you can imagine pouring perfect love through your soul as a liquid, what that would feel like. After 29 years showing him how much I hated him, doing every wicked thing I could even think of. His response to me was to pour out such love in me that I never knew existed. That's the God we serve. Amen. I didn't know he was like that. I would have followed him a lot sooner. But that's the God we serve, and he just blew all my circuits. And I suddenly began hoping again that I was loved by God. Well, I knew I was loved by God, but that I could walk according to his wishes. And so what we're going to show you now is a video that we're putting together. It's a documentary. It's going to be out in June, but we've put together little pieces of it to let you see some testimonies of people who have come out of the lifestyle as I have.
Do you think people are born gay?
Yes.
No.
I don't know.
I believe that it's a choice that they make.
Spiritual-wise, you're a prisoner of the devil.
Certain people may be born a certain way. Certain events may make them become a certain way.
So were you born gay?
I think I was. I mean, I always thought of it.
I believe so. My mother's gay.
I know there are some people that say it's a gene. And
was I born to other tendencies in life? I don't think so. I think it's a learned.
The Bible says it's an abomination.
I don't know anything about what the Bible says.
Oh, flat out, it's wrong. It's sin. It's abomination.
For me personally, I don't believe it's a sin.
God, you tested it.
Don't get me started on the Bible.
I don't need to quote it. Everybody knows the scriptures.
And there at my church, I'm sure there's plenty of homosexuals.
There's absolutely no evidence that anyone is born gay. In fact, the lesbian journalist Camille Paglia famously said, "No one is born gay. The idea is ridiculous."
If they weren't born that way, how did they get that way?
We know that certain people grow out of homosexual desires or grow into them later in life. With lesbians in particular, there's a lot of evidence of fluidity, of people going back and forth.
There's always a cause and an effect.
In their minds, it feels like they're born gay, and it's very deep-seated. But there's no evidence someone's actually born that way.
In most cases, the cause can be identified fairly easily. I was abused by my babysitter or my brother or some cousin, or I saw this porno film or whatever else, and that's when it began.
People may have genetic predispositions to go in a certain direction. And then if you put that in the right environment, if you put that together with other ingredients, that could lead to same-sex attraction. But as they often say, correlation is not causation.
All the evidence leads us to the conclusion that the attempt to have sex with male visitors, men with men, is not incidental to the offense, but actually is an integral element of the offenses committed at Sodom.
If you go to Genesis 19, the Sodom and Gomorrah story, we know from Ezekiel 16 there are a bunch of issues that were happening there.
Philo, an Alexandrian Jew from Egypt, and Josephus, a Palestinian Jew. Both of them have several texts that refer to the Sodom story in Genesis 19, and both of them refer to the attempt to have sex with males, irrespective of whether it's coercive or consensual, as being an abominable act in line with the Levitical prohibitions. So that's how the text would have been read in the first century.
Be thou holy, for I, the Lord thy God, am holy.
My earliest childhood memories of the dysfunction of sexual brokenness came in as a result of a friend of a family molesting me as a little boy at 6 years of age.
If there was a deficit at the parental level, it was that my father just wasn't there.
I grew up without a father until I was about four. I had a stepfather that came into the picture, and he was a very abusive man.
I never heard from my father, "I love you. You're my son, you're good."
In my heart, I held a lot of hostility towards my father because I didn't know where he was. I didn't know why he wasn't there for me.
My mom says my first full sentence was, "I wish I was a boy."
I remember in fourth grade, I went to a birthday party. And at this birthday party, I was raped by several men.
I was sexually molested by a teen, about a 13-year-old boy. At 4 years old.
I lived as a gay man for 8 years, from age 14 to 22.
The devil deceived me, and he deceived many, many thousands and thousands of others into believing that we could be happy.
It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that another guy actually can't complete the need.
I thought there was no hope out of this life, and I thought, well, I might as well just embrace it.
I felt like this was what life was about. Just be happy, just dance, just enjoy the music, and be who you are.
I had this memory of putting my hand on her shoulder and thinking to myself, as I looked at my hand on her shoulder, I can see my soul leaving my body and going into her.
I remember sitting in my bed at night, looking at my ceiling, crying myself to sleep, saying, God, I don't want to be like this.
As soon as I asked him to be Lord and Savior of my life, joy filled my life. Joy. The essence of joy.
I fell on my face before God, and I began to ask him, how could you love me knowing all that I've done? When I got up, I was a new man. I was a new creation. All the old things had passed away, and my life had become new.
Satan wants to say, you can never be free. You can never stop wanting women. You've been going with women for 30 years. I stand as evidence that the Holy Spirit can and will change you if you give God your whole heart.
When I experienced the love of the Father the way that I did on December 1st, 2002, I'm telling you, my life was changed. And I realized that I'm not a burden. I'm not a burden, and that he created me for his glory.
They know I was in the same thing that they were in. They know that I was stuck in the same flesh, you know, struggle that they were stuck in. But I am free.
I wanted to start with that DVD because it communicates massive amounts of hope. I want to start with hope today. I want to end with hope today. The church needs to know that God has not forsaken or abandoned loving people who are hurting and broken. People who are hurting and broken need to know that God hasn't abandoned them. One of the things that we have to get a biblical perspective on as we start to get into this issue, because it's an attack from culture. It's a misrepresentation of what the scripture says. And I hear it all the time. It's this issue of judging, okay? And you hear people say, who are you to judge me? Don't judge me. You can't judge me. We're not supposed to judge one another. And where that has come from, beloved, is a twisting and an incompleteness of what the scripture, what Jesus himself actually taught. And so this area of judgment, I want to just start right there so that you can understand your place as a follower of Jesus. And the important difference between judging by way of discerning and judging by way of condemning. Two totally different things. One we're called to, the other we're not. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 7, verses 1 and 2, Jesus said, judge not that you be not judged. And many people stop right there and go, see, that's what Jesus said. We can't judge anybody or anything. Well, number one, they don't know what the actual word judge means there. But let's continue on with what Jesus did say. Jesus said, for with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it's going to be measured back to you. Now, that word judgment there, friends, is a Greek word which means to fully condemn, to assign somebody as being eternally damned, hopeless, and outside of the reach of the grace of God. Okay? So Jesus said, if you are going to condemn people like that, with that kind of condemnation, he said, that's what you're going to end up getting yourself. You're going to bring that upon yourself, okay? Because we're not called to judge with condemnation. But what we are called to do is to judge in a discerning way, to judge with righteous judgment, as Jesus said in John 7:24. He said, don't judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. That just means to discern. To judge with righteous judgment is to see what God's word says and then discern accordingly whether any action or lifestyle or opinion or behavior is righteous or not, whether it lines up with God's word, will, and way. And so, Christian, anybody who tells you, you can't judge me, you have to ask them, well, what kind of judgment are you talking about? If you're talking about that I can't condemn you, you're absolutely right. I would never do that. Would never condemn you until you're hopelessly lost. But if you're asking me to somehow check my brain at the door and not be able to discern, okay, what it is that you're telling me as whether it's right or wrong and in line with God's word, will, and way, I can't do that because I am called to judge, to discern with righteous judgment. So do you all understand the difference between righteous judgment, which we're called to do, which is a discerning judgment, as opposed to a condemning, hopeless, damning judgment? Do you understand the difference? One we're never allowed to do, the other we're actually called to do. And let's make sure when we're discerning and judging a situation that we're always going to do it with mercy and with compassion, always. David, I want to talk for a minute about deception because we started this series a few weeks ago. Perilous times will come, and last week we unpacked the fact that the number one indicator or characteristic of the day in the last days, according to Jesus, would be that there would be massive deception.
Yeah.
And so could you talk for a few minutes about deception?
Well, back in the 50s, the gay activist movement sort of got off the ground and into the 60s. And then in the 70s, when I was in Hollywood, it was really getting itself together in terms of manipulating the media and so forth and so on. I mean, you knew you weren't going to get a part from a certain director if you weren't in line with the pro-gay position. It was as simple as that. So there's this subtle control that went on. And then now it's in the media full-blown. I mean, Disney just added two gay characters to their latest cartoon. So this has been going on for a while, but in the 80s, they really got their act together, and a guy named Marshall Kirk and another one named Erastus Pill and a third one named Madsen, who were PhD-level social reengineering types, they really knew their stuff, came up with a strategy to overturn the moral order and to create a new moral order where homosexuality is a blessing and something that is holy. And so they laid out their strategy, and I have an article from Christopher Street Magazine from December of 1984, and I've taken 5 of their 10 points out just to give you an idea of how well thought out the strategy is and how well enacted it has become. Number one, they suggest that the gay community desensitize the public to the issue so that they become indifferent to homosexuality, like it's just another ice cream flavor. And so what you see now is this pervasive, ubiquitous presence of gay characters in all the shows and everything, and every talk show, and every legislation, and every court case, constant barrage of talking about it and talking about it and talking about it. And people just get beat up and just go, I'm out of here. And they lose interest and they stop opposing it. As a result, very smart. Number two, portray gays as victims, not as aggressive challengers. And so there's been this whole effort to show gays as the ones who are getting beaten up and the ones who are, and they are getting beaten up in some cases, I don't mean to deny that, but as though they're uniquely special in that category, that other people aren't attacked like they are. There are plenty of bullies in school beating up a lot of people. In fact, I was bullied throughout my childhood. And it wasn't because of any homosexuality in me that the bully saw. But this whole attempt to create a victim mentality so that and this is how they word it, so that the straights will be compelled to protect us. So if we can make ourselves victims, the straights will want to protect us because their hearts will be touched by the victimization that they see. So it's a very well thought out strategy. Third, make gays look favorable, even moral pillars of society. So there's a lot of effort to show, you know, Michelangelo was gay and so forth and so on. They're trying to prop up all the people who were homosexual as though the homosexual was the admirable trait, not the artistic talent. And that's worked very well. When I was in Hollywood, every other person trying to bed me was telling me who was gay in Hollywood. You know, did you know Rock Hudson's gay? And what they're trying to do is to break me down to let me believe that it's just inevitable, it's happening all the time, it's no big deal, just go ahead and try it. And that's going on in our schools today. Fourth, make the victimizers look bad, is what they suggested. And that means showing Westboro Baptist Church types saying God hates fags on the TV ad infinitum, so that people think that evangelical Christians are all like that, that we're hate-filled. I was on the Dr. Phil show a few years ago, and we had 2 days of taping. The first day was the roll-in taping, and it was just me and the producer and the cameraman. And I was answering her questions, and at certain points she would go, no, you can't say that. And I was just taken aback. Well, why am I here then if you don't want what I have to say? You know, I wasn't saying anything mean or hateful. Actually, that's what she wanted me to say. So she said, you can't say that. You have to say this. And she told me what I had to say. And I told her, look, I'm going to tell you what I believe. I'm not going to parrot. So it's that imbued in the manipulation of media. They had me in to be the bigoted, hateful Christian, and I wasn't playing the part. And what they ended up doing was re-editing my words so that I was saying stuff I wasn't actually saying when the show went live. Number five, undermine the moral authority of homophobic churches by portraying them as antiquated backwaters, badly out of step with the times and what the latest findings of psychology are. Use talk to muddy the moral waters by publicizing support for gays by the more moderate churches and by raising theological objections of our own about conservative interpretations of biblical teaching.
So there's 5 of 10 points that were in print 30 years ago to set a course to change culture, and not just to change culture, but to actually infiltrate the beliefs and doctrines, teachings of the church. And when I read to you these next two examples, that one is 7 weeks old and one is 1 week old, just to show you how, you know, alive this is. This isn't something that's going away, it's actually increasing. But you remember about 7 weeks ago when Phil Robertson from Duck Dynasty made his comments that I surely wouldn't have said them that way, but made some comments in a Gentleman's Quarterly interview. He was stating what the Bible was stating and then added some of his own commentary. Again, I'm not commenting on his commentary, but when he stated what the scripture said, it got him in a lot of trouble. It was all that the news was talking about. And then there was the spokesperson, Wilson Cruz, for the Gay Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation, said this. Look at this. Phil and his family claim to be Christian, but Phil's lies about an entire community fly in the face of what true Christians believe. Wilson went on and said, by taking quick action and removing Robertson from future filming, A&E has sent a strong message that discrimination is neither a Christian nor an American value. Now, if you read that with any judgment, with any discernment, a couple things should point out that should become clear to you really quick. First of all, we have the spokesperson for GLAAD defining what true Christians believe. I'm just guessing there might be a little difference there. And then going on and saying that just saying what the Bible says is discrimination rather than sharing opinion. And so it's that subtle. But that is the carrying out 7 weeks ago of the agenda from 30 years ago. It's muddying the waters. It's using words like discrimination instead of stating your right to free speech and opinion. Well, last Sunday, to make it even a little more recent, the Grammys were on. The county of Los Angeles gave permission to Queen Latifah to do a mass wedding ceremony on the Grammys. And again, I'm just going, what does this have to do with musical achievement? And so, but it's part of the agenda. And so here's this mass marriage ceremony of both homo and heterosexual couples, but it's all being built up and okayed, the stamp of approval, as they're singing Macklemore's song, Same Love, which is trying to promote this agenda of equality and same and likeness, just another flavor, all of that. And so our culture's being bombarded with this, right? Now, I want to give you just the first verse of this song, Same Love, because it's this kind of stuff that goes across the airwaves that the next generation, people much younger than you and I, are listening to, and they hear that more than they hear God's truth. And so it starts to shape their thinking, okay? So the song, Same Love. The right-wing conservatives think it's a decision, and you can be cured with some treatment and religion. Man-made rewiring of a predisposition. Plain God. Ah, nah, here we go. America the brave still fears what we don't know, and God loves all his children is somehow forgotten. But we paraphrase a book written 3,500 years ago. Now that should get your attention, Christian. And the rest of the song, I mean, it goes from bad to worse. It just continues. Now, this issue of God loving all of his children, there's absolutely no question that God loves everybody. But to say that God's love means that God is approving of all of my choices is incorrect. That's not being honest. God's love for us is unconditional. It's never been based on our performance to earn his love. We're only able to love him because he first loved us. But you use a little bit of God language and God loves all of his children and then demeaning the authority of the scripture and saying, oh, these people who believe this, they're right-wing conservatives, and you know, this is a book that they're paraphrasing from that's 3,500 years old. See, 3,500 years old. Antiquated backwaters. So it's painting this picture. It's political. It's right wing. It's a book that they're taking out of context, that they're paraphrasing. And it gets drilled into the heads of our youth because they listen to this music and they see it on the Grammys and it's all over the place. Okay? If you think there's not a very aggressive agenda to promote the homosexual agenda, I don't know what you're paying attention to. Maybe you're not paying attention to anything. Now, we go on, and I mentioned a guy last week, Rob Bell, who was raised in a good Bible-believing church, pastored a church up in Michigan for years, and then wrote his book a few years ago, Love Wins, which was the deception of universalism, where hell isn't eternal, nobody's going to go there forever, and everybody's going to go to heaven. This is a 2,000-year-old heresy that he repackaged and sold a bill of goods to people for. Well, then it shouldn't surprise us that his next big statement that's come out recently is that God is for homosexuality and for same-sex attraction, and that it's okay. And his direct quote very recently was, "The old way doesn't work, it only causes pain." The old way. You mean the 3,500-year-old antiquated backwater way? This is a guy who was a pastor at one time. Falling prey, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, promoting the pro-gay, pro-homosexual agenda. Since left his church and on, but we see this deception. It's gone on throughout the church. The Episcopal Church, July 2012, approved the blessing for same-sex relationships. The Evangelical Lutheran Church of America, 2009, blessing same-sex unions. The PC Presbyterian Church USA, 2000, blessing same-sex unions. The United Church of Christ, 2005, legally recognizing and advocating for same-sex marriage. The Church of England, just very, very recently, said that gay men who are in civil partnerships, so long as they're celibate, can become bishops in the church. Okay, so I'm just telling you, this is what's real in the world. This is what's going on that we can't just, you know, keep a blind eye to. We have to pay attention to this stuff. We have to have an answer. We have to know what we believe and why we believe it. Very sobering stuff.
Yeah, and I was raised in the church. My father was a pastor, and then I was in seminary, and I've been in many denominations and seeing the church at work on the inside. And this has been going on for many, many decades, probably since the 40s and 50s, this liberalization of the church, particularly the mainline denominations, whereby people gain power in the upper echelons of the denominational structures, and then they appoint their friends, and then they appoint the professors for the seminaries, and then they take over the diocesan leadership and the presbytery leadership, so that then they can begin screening out any conservative candidate for pastor or priest. And this has been going on unbeknownst to the average person in the pew for many, many decades. And the mainline churches are just collapsing one by one like dominoes as a result.
Yeah. So let's talk about this issue of marriage for just a moment. We're kind of moving on a little bit from deception to what does Jesus say about marriage. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19, verses 3 through 5 says, "The Pharisees also came to Jesus, testing him and saying to him, 'Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason?' And Jesus answered and said to them, 'Have you not read?'" Real quick, anytime we don't read what God's word said, we're close to trouble, okay? Jesus said to him, "Have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female and said, 'For this reason, a man shall leave his father and be joined to his wife and the two shall become one flesh.'" So here's Jesus, the Son of God, 2,000 years ago, referring to Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, which was 1,500 years before his time. So yes, Jesus believed in antiquated backwater theology. Jesus made clear that marriage is between one man and one woman, period. One of the disturbing parts about this to me is if the pro-gay agenda wants to have civil unions or civil partnerships or whatever, why aren't they satisfied not only getting that, but why aren't they satisfied calling it a civil partnership or a civil union? Why is there this insistence on redefining the word marriage that God came up with that said it's between one man and one woman? You see, this isn't a passive thing. This isn't being satisfied with just equal rights. We want equal labels and equal titles, and so we want you to call this marriage. Well, God says it's not marriage. Jesus says it's not marriage. I personally take issue with the redefining of the word marriage. And don't hijack a biblical word to try to make your case look more holy when it is unholy.
I agree, Steve. You know, Jesus reaffirmed the law in the Old Testament in Matthew 5, 17 through 19, saying that he did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. And that word fulfill means to fill out the meaning of. So he came to fulfill the law, every jot and tittle of it, he said, and that anyone teaching otherwise would be considered least in the kingdom of God. So Jesus maybe never mentioned it. Maybe he did. Not everything Jesus said is written down. He didn't have to because the culture was already on board with that. He didn't mention pedophilia or many other things as well. So there was no need for him to mention it in the culture in which he lived. Yeah. But even if he never mentioned it, he did reaffirm the Old Testament law where it is forbidden.
Yeah. One of the passages of Scripture that I don't hear many conservative teachers using for this point is Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. I want you to look at this. This is Jesus speaking, and he says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven," which if you just pause there for a second, it means that there's going to be people who have lived their lives so deceived that when they stand before Jesus, they're going to actually call him Lord, Lord. Like, hey, Lord, like, you know me, it's me. And he says, not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, is going to enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. And so what is the will of the Father? The will of the Father is revealed in the word and the ways of God. And so Jesus said, heaven is for those who are participating and practicing in the will of my Father. And he goes on to say, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name or cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name? In other words, we've participated in religious activity. Our church has done things that, you know, look religious, that have a form of godliness, but resist the power thereof. Okay? And then Jesus is going to declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Now, would you all say lawlessness? Lawlessness, beloved, encompasses every single topic that is a violation of the law of God. And so although Jesus might never have mentioned homosexuality because there was absolutely no need to in first century Christianity or the time of Christ, there was no need to mention it specifically because everybody understood that that was contained in the word lawlessness. It was a violation of what God's law said. And so, again, the point that David made a minute ago, Jesus didn't talk about a lot of things. It doesn't make them right. We just have to understand that lawlessness and the breaking, the violation of God's law encompasses a bunch of things. And some people are going to have a serious wake-up when they stand before God after participating in religious behavior while living an unrepentant, sinful life. It's going to be a sobering moment for them. My heartbeat, our passion is to say, hey, let's look at what all of the Scripture says. And for my life as well as yours, like, let's get in line with what the Scripture says. And where I need to repent, I need to repent. And where you need to repent, you need to repent. But let's all get in line with what God's will is so that we don't hear those words, depart from me, I never knew you. David, let's talk about God's law on homosexuality for a minute.
Let's look at the key text in the Old Testament about this, Leviticus 18, 22 to 23. It says, you shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. Now notice the it. The it is not referring to the person. It's referring to the act. So homosexuals are not abominations, and we should never even suggest such a thing. Right. It is the act of lying with a male as with a woman. It is the abomination. Nor shall you mate with any animal to defile yourself, nor any woman stand before an animal to mate with it. It is perversion. So God's law couldn't be clearer. Just because Jesus never mentioned it among his disciples doesn't mean it wasn't already agreed upon in that milieu. That's a hard word to say.
Yeah. So this issue now, because then people will say, oh, you're quoting the Old Testament, and that's the law. And so are you saying now that we need to keep all of the law? which, you know, we need to stone our rebellious teenagers and we need to eat certain dietary foods, and they make a mockery of it. And in the midst of making a mockery of it, what they're really doing is just showing their own ignorance, because they don't understand that the law of God, it consists of four main points. The first part of it is the moral law of God. The moral law of God is unchanging from covenant to covenant. Old covenant or new covenant, the moral law of God is unchanging. Next is the civil law of God. The civil law was the law that we got as Americans a bunch of our laws from. We took principles from the old covenant and applied various levels of application to that. But specifically, the civil law for the Jew in the old covenant was because they were living under a theocracy. They were living under as God's covenant people. And so the civil law for the Jew 3,500 years ago, the civil law for the Jew doesn't have authority over us as it did for them then. The next kind of law is the ceremonial law. The ceremonial law is the keeping of feasts and of certain holy days or holidays, and keeping Passover and Sabbaths and dietary laws, all those kind of things. The scripture tells us in the new covenant that we're not under those anymore. And then finally, fourthly, we know from the new covenant that we're not under the sacrificial law. The sacrificial law was what? The killing of bulls and of goats and of pigeons, the shedding of their blood for the remission of our sin. And so the only part of God's law that is alive and active for everybody around the world today that he holds us all to is the idea that we are accountable for the moral law of God. And what does the moral law of God tell us? Well, it's going to tell us something in the old covenant that is unchanging in the new, and we're able to discover what is still applicable to us, the parts of the moral law in the new covenant, by what it says. And so what we're looking to do with this issue of homosexuality is say, what does the old covenant say about it? And then does the new covenant say anything specifically about it?
And homosexuality, the prohibition against homosexual practice is repeated in the New Testament several times. So that's the tip off that it's part of the moral law, which is a reflection of God's moral character. It can never change.
Yeah. So now we get into the New Testament, where very specifically the Apostle Paul is writing about the sin of homosexuality and talking to the church and warning the church about it. Now, all of Romans chapter 1 would be well worth your reading. It goes into more detail than I'm going to right now for time's sake. But I want you to look at Romans chapter 1, verses 27 through 29, and then verse 32, just for a quick glance at it. Paul says, "Likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, and wickedness." Now, verse 32, "Who, knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them." So, unpack this quickly, one little bit at a time here. First of all, the Apostle Paul says that to leave the natural use of the woman as a man, that it's wrong, that it's shameful, that it's not fitting, that it's sexual immorality and wickedness. The next sobering thing that he says that we have to get a grip on and understand what he is saying and what he isn't saying is that those who practice this lifestyle and that those who approve of those who practice this lifestyle are worthy of death. Oh my gosh, Steve, are you saying that we're supposed to start killing people? God forbid. Not only am I not saying we're not supposed to kill people, we're not to even belittle people or make fun of people or disrespect people. He's talking about spiritual death and separation from God. He's talking about unregenerate acts and unregenerate activities. And he's saying, if you sell yourself out to those things, you need to know what the end result will be. It's going to be spiritual death and separation from God. It's going to be, depart from me, I never knew you. So this has the most serious language attached to it, which is why I think most people, pastors, preachers, whatever, shrink back from it, because they don't want to take the time to expound upon it in a compassionate way. They're afraid of the pushback and the hate mail and the whatever they're going to get. And I just want to say, beloved, our eternities depend upon a proper interpretation of the Scripture. And if we fail to shriek back from our responsibility, listen, their blood is on our hands. I don't want that for me. I don't want that for any of us. So what Paul says in the New Testament, totally in line with what the Old Covenant says as well. We go on and on. David.
Also in Romans 1, that's where you find lesbianism being also mentioned. So it's really clear in Romans 1. And in the greater context, Paul is saying, God created a natural order. And the example I'm giving you of a breaking of that natural order is homosexual practice, whether male or female. So that's the point he's making there.
Yeah. 1 Timothy, Paul writes in chapter 1, verse 10, he mentions fornicators and sodomites, kidnappers, liars, perjurers. And then he says, if there's any other thing that, look at, is contrary to sound doctrine. So listen, beloved, he doesn't just mention the sodomite or the practicing homosexual. He also mentions, are you ready for this? Fornicators, which are heterosexuals who are involved in any sexual act outside of marriage. So just to be clear this morning, and to be very clear, again, we're not up here hating on the homosexual lifestyle and practice and throwing stones at that. As the pastor of this church, I am equally going after heterosexual men who are addicted to pornography, who are unfaithful to their wives on the computer screen, and who are living in heterosexual sin and fornication. Y'all better wake up. Real, yeah, go ahead and clap for that. Real easy to throw stones because it's popular and convenient at those who are practicing homosexual sin. God makes it very clear, heterosexual sin outside of marriage is just as dangerous. He doesn't condone it at all.
And in that 1 Timothy 1:10 passage, he mentions both sides of that coin very clearly. The sexually immoral, that would be the pornoi, which is a Greek word that indicates any kind of sexual immorality. And then the men who practice homosexuality. And I like in the ESV where they make that really clear. It's the men who practice homosexuality. And they are called the arsenikoites in the Greek, which is a word that is found in the 1 Corinthians 6, 9 passage that we're about to go to.
Yeah, 1 Corinthians now. So this is the third part of the New Testament where the Apostle Paul calls it out by name. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, writing to a very promiscuous Corinthian culture. He says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't be deceived. Amen. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of our Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. First of all, promiscuous culture and society, don't be deceived. God has a standard. God draws a line. These behaviors, when practiced unrepentantly, when they're continued and wanting to be legalized and made excuse for, you're not going to enter the kingdom of God. You're not going to enter into heaven. That's not the abode of those activities. That's not the eternal resting place of people that practice those things. And he goes on the list, and again, he points out heterosexual sexual sin, fornicators. And then he says, and such were some of you. This is where this beautiful four-letter word, were, really shines. Were. It means change is possible. And such were some of you. You go ahead and read that list. I'm raising my hand. I was several things on that list. And Steve, you were some of those things. But what happened to me? What happened to Dr. Foster? I was washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And my sins, as though they were red like scarlet, they were made as white as wool. I was washed. I was sanctified. God imputed his holiness upon my life. God declared me to be a holy person. He sanctified me, washed me, made me clean. And then he justified me. He treated me just as if I've never sinned. This is the will of God for every broken person, regardless of your brokenness, in the entire world. God loves you dearly. God demonstrated his love toward you that while you were still a sinner, Christ died for you. You don't have to clean your act up. You just have to get to the point where you say yes to Jesus Christ and you ask him to do for you what you can't do for yourself. He will wash you. He will sanctify you. He will justify you. He will get you on the road to life transformation. This is what Jesus will do. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived in thinking that he can't do it or that he won't do it. He will, and he can, and he's able. And it's because of his radical love for us.
You know, I've been ministering to people with this struggle for over 25 years now, and I personally have been out of the gay lifestyle for 34 years now. So I know that change is possible. And I know that the things that cause homosexual confusion can be discovered and healed by the revelation and the power of God. I know this as much as I know that God exists. I know it absolutely. I've met thousands of people who've come out of the lifestyle and stayed out of the lifestyle. So many of them ended up getting married and having children. They were so healed. So this is very possible. So let me talk a minute about what causes homosexuality so we can get a picture of it. Sexuality is given to us at birth. We are created in a natural order as heterosexuals, but our sexuality at birth is in seed form. It's dormant. It's not meant to germinate until the years of puberty. So what happens to this dormant seed is very important during those years. Does it get the nutrients that it needs? Does it get the water that it needs? Or does it get damaged? These are factors that can set askew the normal, natural, heterosexual orientation that God gives everyone at birth. What are some of those things that mess things up? Well, in male homosexuality, what everyone in the ministry to homosexuals has discovered is that the major cause is a failure to bond with a same-sex parent on an emotional level. Now, this is not a cause in all homosexuals, but this is a primary cause in most homosexuals, especially the males. I would say a good 70-80% of males have this as one of their factors. And I do want to emphasize that there are many factors that converge to create homosexual confusion. It is not ever just one thing. It is a convergence of factors, abuse and various things that converge upon a particular personality who has its own temperament, who has its own family situation, his own experiences. So this is not a cookie-cutter lesson here. It's very complicated. But the primary cause is that failure to bond emotionally, like with my father. My father was very cold and severe and stern. He did not know how to make me feel loved. I felt completely unloved. He did not think it was good to affirm me, because in his Scottish Presbyterian ancestry, to do that would be to make me spoiled. So I didn't get the affirmation or the sense of being loved that I needed. And let me also emphasize here, it's the perception of the child that's key. My father did love me, but I didn't perceive it. And so I got angry. I lashed out back with him and made vows against him in my heart. And I began rebelling against him. And I did not forgive him for many, many years. And so say you have a dad in the family that's beating up mom. Well, a boy's not going to want to be like that dad. So he's going to stick with mom. You know, when you're born, whether you're boy or girl, you are bonded with mom. That's a natural thing that occurs. But with a boy, between the ages of 2 and 5, that boy has to transition from a bonding with mom to a bonding with dad. He has to come into a knowledge and feeling good about himself being made male and masculine. And so there's this window that has been proven repeatedly in study after study after study, where the boy has to transfer his identity from the mom to the dad. Now, any number of things can mess that up. The dad just might be gone. He might be abusive. He might be really quite nice, but unable to connect emotionally with his son. Why? Because maybe his dad never did that with him. He simply doesn't know how to. So it's not his fault, but that's just the situation, some of the situations you find. In some families, you have situations where they wanted a girl and they got a boy. So they treat the boy when he acts in feminine ways. They approve of the boy when he acts in feminine ways. I see this all the time. The boys who remain bonded with mom or who are pushed into remaining bonded with mom because that's where they get their love and that's where they get their affirmation. And this is how effeminacy develops. The boy begins to take on the feminine characteristics and traits and behaviors because that's the group that he's bonded with and identifies with. I mean, if dad is beating up mom, he wants to be like mom. He doesn't want to be like dad, and that connection is difficult to create. So in the healing process, and this is the exciting thing that I found, in the healing process, you begin, once you're born again, you begin nurturing an intimate relationship with God, the Father in particular. Now, Jesus told us to pray to the Father, so even Jesus saw this as a real key for living the Christian life, an intimate relationship with the Father himself. And when I began doing that, and I would do it through reading the Word, I went off to seminary and got into the Word, and then I went to the Vineyard for many years, and I learned how to worship, and I would sing love songs to the Lord at night, and in the middle of singing love songs to him, every once in a while, he would say, David, here's a route to your bondage, and this is what to do about it. And he reparented me directly while I was worshiping him, while I was reading his Word, when I would go to conferences where there were leaders teaching on this subject, while I was getting ministry in ministry lines, while I was going to small groups. And that's where I got a lot of healing, was in small home fellowship groups where I could let myself be known as who I really was and not be judged, and find a group of people who are other than me who accepted me nevertheless. That was very, very important. Another very important thing for my healing was the acceptance of heterosexual men. You see, when I came out of the lifestyle, I had never hugged a man non-sexually, and a man had never hugged me non-sexually. I simply did not know how to interact non-sexually with men. And so I was convinced that the heterosexual men in the church would just run, you know, from me the second they heard of my struggle. But in a small home fellowship group, I was able to begin trusting certain people and revealing myself to them and receiving affirmations from them and hearing them tell me, you know, we don't understand your struggle, but we're behind you anyway, and we'll stay here and pray with you to the end.
Amen.
And that was one of the most healing things. Let me tell you the story of the men's fellowship group I went to at John Wimber's church. 500 men. I didn't want to hug them because I didn't know. I might hug them too tight. I might hug them too long. And then they'd find out I was homosexual. And so I did not like hugging But at the end, it was a force hug. It was a forced hug. Everybody stand up and hug. So I had to hug this guy, and he was like a Paul Bunyan guy. And he just envelops me in this hug. And I was not expecting this. When I was being suffocated in this hug, I suddenly experienced the Father himself hugging me. He used the hug of that man to communicate his own affection for me. That was one of the most powerfully healing moments of my entire life. And it was through the heterosexual men in the church not judging me, not condemning me, but standing with me even if they didn't understand. But very important.
David said something to me very, very powerful yesterday, because there's the potential for shame on so much of what we've talked about today, from the person who's struggling to even the parent of people who are struggling, and then parents wondering, oh my gosh, what did I do wrong? And it's important to say that Adam and Eve had the best father in the world, and they still found their way to sin.
Yes. Very, very important.
Okay, so if you're in that position this morning, listen, no shame, no condemnation, no guilt, whatever. Like, let's just figure out if that was a part of it that happened unknowingly, and let's get it fixed.
Yeah.
But no guilt, no shame, and maybe you had absolutely nothing to do with it, and it was just this other issue, and we are wrapping it up, although we could go much longer. But my heart particularly breaks for the people that I've dealt with, David, that's much less than you, but I have in 25 years. I watched the video, David's video, of the boy, several of them, but the one young man in particular, who at 4 years of age went to a birthday party, and several men molested and abused him. Like, I watched that and just go, well, that little four-year-old bro didn't sign up for that. He didn't ask those men to do that to him. He's just four going to a little birthday party. Supposed to be safe and innocent, you know. Like, my heart goes out for that, bro. Like, massively.
He is a powerful evangelist today. Powerful evangelist. And child abuse is one of the other major factors. Over 65% of all lesbians are victims of child abuse. And so they have this hurt from men. And as was stated in the video, some lesbians actually choose the lesbian lifestyle in reaction to the hurt that they've gotten from men. And that's why there's such fluidity among lesbians, going back and forth. I'm gay now, I'm straight now, I'm, you know, like Anne Heche going from her gay lover to getting married to a man. This is much more common among female homosexuals. But even with male homosexuals, over half of all male homosexuals are sexual abuse victims as well. So it affects both sides of the coin massively. And part of the healing process is going through a healing program for childhood sexual abuse.
I want to end this part of this as the pastor of this church to say this. If our hearts aren't radically compassionate, if our hearts aren't really, really patient, if we're not welcoming and inviting, not approving, not condoning, but like if we can't get this right, if we can't give hurting, struggling people the Paul Bunyan bear hug that you got, we're missing the heart of Jesus. If we give a wink and a grin to heterosexual sin and we go after vehemently homosexual sin, we're missing it. We're deceived ourselves. I want to say today that this church is open to whatever broken person walks in these doors. And we can love without condoning, and we can speak truth without hating. And we might just be able to love somebody into the kingdom of God. We might be able to be a real reflection of the heartbeat of Jesus that said to the woman caught in adultery, I don't condemn you, but go and sin no more. We can get this right, y'all. We must get it right. In your bulletins, there's a bunch of additional resources. Websites, all kinds of stuff, DVDs. I want to just point out a couple things to you right now that we have down in the Resource Center. Dr. Foster said, Steve, there's four very, very fantastic books that we should make available to people if we really want to resource them and equip them. The first book that I want to show you is Kay Arthur's book, The Truth About Sex. Dr. Foster said this is single best book out there on sex, and go ahead and get it. I'm sure you could Kindle it or whatever if we run out down there. The second one would be Joe Dallas's book, When Homosexuality Hits Home. This is geared toward those who have a friend, family member, particularly someone very close to you, that has let you know about their homosexual practice or same-sex attraction. Great book for that. Pursuing Sexual Wholeness by Andrew Comiskey. This is a great book for people who are struggling with male homosexuality. And so if that hits close to home for you by way of a family or friend relationship, this is the book to get for males. The sexual healing book, David's Own Story, a fantastic guide to finding freedom from sexual sin and brokenness. All of these books.
Actually, it's not my story. It's just a teaching on sexual brokenness. My story comes out in May.
Your book, I'm sorry. David's teaching, his book, but his story does come out in May as well. So all four of these, we got them, $10 for whichever book that you want. I would encourage everybody to buy all of them so that we can learn how to minister to people effectively. So again, your sheet, lots of website information, videos to watch, all that kind of stuff. So Grace Chapel, who knows what the future holds for me or this church. But if we can love people and share the truth with them so that their testimony might be, I was instead of I am, then when we face God, I'm convinced we will hear those words. Well done, good and faithful servant. Let's love people well, and let's not hold back the truth. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
Well, let's close in prayer. Father, we want to thank you for your graciousness toward us in unpacking these issues today. There's so much to absorb and yet so much more to try to wrap our brains around. We'd ask for your help, O God, because we need it. And people need it. People need help. They need love. And we're asking, oh God, that your church might be able to get this part right. God, help us. God, help us. God, stretch us. God, keep us grounded. One more time, we commit our hearts to you, and we thank you for the unbelievable mercy you have shown everyone in this room. For our own sins have been many and heinous, and yet you chose to wash us, to sanctify us, and to justify us. Thank you, O God, for what you've done in us. Now may it happen through us for the saving of lives. In the merciful name of Jesus, the powerful Son of God. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you and keep you.
Thank you, David.
Dr. Foster, thank you.